from the heart of where innovation, money, and power collide. In Silicon Valley and beyond, this is Bloomberg Technology with Emily Chang.
I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco, and this is Bloomberg Technology. Coming up in the next hour, build your own bike. As Peloton looks to cut costs, the fitness company is planning a redesign so that customers can assemble their own bikes at home. Will customers spin for it? We'll discuss. Plus, activist investor Dan Loeb is calling for changes at Disney. Details on his new stake and why he is urging a spin-off of ESPN. And how Google Maps routinely misleads people searching for abortion clinics. Why, and why it's ever more critical in a post-Roe world. More on our Bloomberg analysis later this hour. We'll get to all of that in a moment, but first I want to get a look at the market. Stocks rising for a second trading day in a row. The tech-heavy NASDAQ 100 outperforming with Tesla, Apple, Microsoft, and NVIDIA leading the gains. Bloomberg's Christine Aquino joins us now for more. Christine, walk us through the day.
Well, Emily, you know, we started the week with bad news out of China coming in the form of a surprise rate cut and after some pretty big economic misses in July. But you really would not know that just looking at a price action in the U.S. equity market today. It's green across the board with the S&P 500 closing up 0.4 higher on the day. And that comes off a string of 4 weeks of gains already, and that's propelling that index up 18% from those year-to-date lows that we saw in June. And of course, the NASDAQ 100 also following in the S&P 500's footsteps, up even higher, about 0.7 on the day. And of course, the story of the day, or one of the big corporate stories of the day, is of course Disney. I know, Emily, you're going to be digging into that a little bit later, but it's making headlines today, as you mentioned, because of Dan Loeb and his company Third Point taking a stake in the company. He was very much not shy about suggesting some of those changes that he'd like to see to Disney CEO Bob Chapek. And some of them include a potential spinoff of the ESPN division. I know that you're going to be digging into that story for us later, Emily. And of course, the semiconductor index as well, rebounding toward the end of the day. That was down earlier, but finishing the day 0.3% higher. Now, if you take a look at those, some of those Chinese ADRs, you really will be hard-pressed to see as well the impact of the China news. Alibaba, of course, a key gauge of consumer sentiment, perhaps bearing the brunt of the pain, closing lower or trading lower by 0.6%. But then some of its more notable competitors, Pinduoduo and JD.com, both trading higher on the day. Pinduoduo, of course, the clear outperformer here, up more than 4%. But again, if you zoom out to the performance of China tech versus U.S. tech over the past year, you can really see that divergence is very, very clear. We see that the Golden Dragon China Index, this NASDAQ Golden Dragon China Index, really still extending those gains. It's down 30% over the past year. Meanwhile, the NASDAQ 100, while it is still down on a one-year time frame, it has staged that recovery since the middle of June and has now pared those declines to just 10% over the past year. So we're going to be, I know we're going to be digging into some of those stories there, Emily. It is very much a feeling of summer markets here, but still lots to talk about.
All right, Christine, thank you very much. And to that Disney story, activist investor Dan Loeb urging Disney to make a sweeping set of changes to boost shareholder value, including new board members and spinning off ESPN. Loeb's Third Point taking what it calls a significant stake in Disney. Here to discuss, Paul Verna of Insider Intelligence and Bloomberg's Liana Baker. Liana, some of the changes that Dan Loeb is calling for here, not necessarily new ideas. I mean, we've heard talk about spinning off ESPN for years. What is Dan Loeb suggesting and why?
Well, that's right, Emily. In the letter, if you read it, Loeb actually says Disney might be working on some of these things already, although sources close to Disney tell me, you know, there's not going to be an ESPN spinoff anytime soon. But some of the other things that Loeb is calling for, like cost cuts and buying a stake in Hulu from Comcast, these are things that investors have kind of been expecting for years. And this is Loeb's second bite of the apple at Disney. In 2020, remember, he had also taken a stake and asked for changes like Disney scrapping the dividend and putting all that investment into the streaming product. Those are things that Disney never really did. So we'll see if he has a better shot this time around. Loeb is a big name in the world of activist investing. He's shaken up companies like Yahoo and Sony over the years, but he does have a mixed track record as to really seeing the changes that he's asking for.
Loeb's letter to Disney initially starts off, you know, fairly flattering to CEO Bob Chapek. Then he sort of digs in, saying ESPN is a great business that currently generates significant free cash flow. Despite these advantages, we believe a strong case can be made that ESPN should be spun off to shareholders with an appropriate debt load that'll alleviate leverage at the parent company. Disney responding sort of thanks, not quite, but not quite no thanks, saying we welcome the views of all our investors. As our results demonstrate, the Walt Disney Company continues to deliver strong financial results powered by world-class storytelling and our unique and highly valuable content creation and distribution ecosystem. Paul, what do you make of this?
Well, I think it's always good to stir the pot. You know, dialogue is always helpful, and it's interesting to put out these ideas. But I don't think, if I were Bob Chapek, I'm keeping ESPN. I'm not spinning it off. ESPN does a lot of things for Disney. Sports, for one, it does a couple of things that no other form of entertainment does. One is you have loyalty. So, you know, someone is more likely to tune out the next season of The Mandalorian if they don't like a plot twist or something about the casting, but they're not likely to just stop watching Major League Baseball or La Liga or whatever else they watch on ESPN. And then there's this whole thing about appointment viewing, which is something that's kind of a vestige to bygone days, but it still exists in sports because a game is taking place when it takes place and people want to watch it. So I think there's a lot of benefit to having ESPN as part of that portfolio. It's not an accident that every other media company that Disney competes with has a major sports entity as part of their mix.
Leanna, you know, what do we know about Loeb's track record and how likely it is that he'll be successful here, especially with a company like Disney?
It's hard to say. There was a vaguely threatening line in the letter today where he said that there's a talent gap on Disney's board and that he has good connections and could maybe make some introductions to Disney. Now, I don't know, you know, who Disney needs to meet that doesn't know already, but the idea there is that he's floating out with investors to see if they'll support him maybe in a board fight. So right now, Disney, their window for directors would open later this fall, so Loeb would have a few months to see if he wants to do a board fight. He really does have a mixed track record at taking over boards. At Yahoo, back in 2012, he had a lot of success, although history will tell whether, you know, Marissa Meyer was the right move. At Sotheby's, the company went private, but it was a really long haul. It took several years, and Sony still hasn't made a lot of the changes he's wanted. So while he's a big name, it's not clear that, you know, even though he's going after this blue chip company, that's a slam dunk that all of this will come true.
Gosh, I remember covering that Yahoo Loeb Marissa Meyer story every day for, gosh, at least a year. Paul, what do you make of some of these other changes? New board members, you know, full ownership of Hulu. Again, as I said earlier, not necessarily new ideas, but, you know, something that several investors have been calling for a while, but hasn't happened.
Well, I think that Disney buying the share that it doesn't own in Hulu from Comcast is a good idea. So I agree with Dan Loeb on that one. There's a lot of tension within Disney because on the one hand, you know, there's a deadline to execute this deal by 2024. So obviously it's in Disney's best interest for the price of that chunk to be as low as possible. So it's almost like a weird motivation to drive down the value of Hulu. And that's just a very tense situation that's going to unfold for the next couple of years. Disney already has a controlling interest in Hulu. And in my view, they're doing a great job with Hulu. I don't see that they should fold it into Disney Plus necessarily. I think it's a very strong brand on its own. So I see a lot of value in basically Disney executing on this earlier, even if, as Dan Loeb says, they have to pay a little bit of a premium for it.
All right. Well, we're going to continue to follow this evolving story. We'll see how long it lasts. Bloomberg's Liana Baker, Paul Verna of Insider Intelligence. Thank you both. And more changes for Peloton after last week's layoffs and price hikes. Think DIY. The struggling fitness brand is retooling its bikes for self-assembly. Yes, that means customers will be able to put them together themselves. This is part of a wide-ranging turnaround for Peloton by its new CEO, Barry McCarthy, who's also planning to launch a rowing machine this year. Bloomberg's Mark Gurman covers all things Peloton for us. So let's get this straight. Peloton just raised prices for the bike. Now it wants customers to put the bikes together themselves?
Yeah, I wonder if Dan Loeb is going to try to get his hands on Peloton as well, because clearly they have a lot of changes to implement here. So yes, one of the initiatives last week as part of the layoffs was really taking their costs and dropping them significantly when it comes to distribution and warehouses, right? So they're laying off over 500 people that work in distribution. Now, if you ever bought a Peloton before, this is how it works, and you know this already. You order it online, and they show up to your house, a white glove service, they bring it in, they unbox it for you, and they set it up for you. That's a $400 fee to consumers, and that's very expensive for the company to really supply and make happen. That's why they're winding down the warehouses. Right now, they're going to start moving to third-party companies, logistics companies, to do that white glove service. The next step is having consumers set these devices up themselves. So they're in the process right now, the CEO told me in an interview last week, of redesigning its equipment so they can ship it via UPS, via FedEx, whatever you want. You take it home, it arrives at your doorstep, you open the box, you put it together yourself. And like you said, DIY. That's obviously not a great customer experience compared to the white glove service. But that would be cheaper for the customer, no longer paying that $400 setup fee, be cheaper for Peloton. And if they have redesigned it in such a way where it's a 15-minute process, right, with just a few parts, it's actually pretty convenient rather than having people come into your house.
We've covered some of the safety issues with Peloton products. I mean, are there any safety issues with this?
Yeah, I mean, I have to tell you, obviously, if you set up a bike incorrectly or the rower or a treadmill incorrectly, right, and that thing falls apart because you didn't do a good job, you know, setting up the device, that's a clear liability issue. So that really comes down to their engineering, their supply chain, their operations, to figure out a way to make these devices work reliably and set up reliably, right? So if you have to have the equipment to do it, the right screwdriver, the right screws, that could be a complicated situation. So that is definitely a consideration. And I guess we just have to hope that Peloton has engineered these things so they could be set up quickly and safely.
You've also reported on products to come, a rowing machine. What else can we expect?
Yeah, so a rowing machine, that's the next major product from Peloton, other than this minor redesign of the bikes to allow for safe self-assembly. That Peloton rowing machine has been in the works for several years now. Barry McCarthy says they're finally probably going to launch it in the holiday season. He hinted at some supply chain snags related to COVID. So let's see if they're able to get that launched. They launched the Guide. That's a TV device that allows the TV device with a camera to follow along and really analyze your workouts and tell you how you're doing. After that, they've also been working on a machine similar to a Tonal and another strength training machine. There's also wearables in the works. They have this heart rate monitor, so maybe they'll expand the wearables business as well. But what I really think is they need to really, you know, probably make a cheaper bike, right? The cheapest bike right now is around $1,500. I think the sweet spot for something like this is probably south of $1,000. They've been pushing their refurbished model. Maybe they can make a really low-end, self-assemblable bike, maybe with a smaller display, less integrated technology, that could really compete with bikes from Echelon and other companies that are simply not charging as much as Peloton.
All right, interesting. We'll continue to follow your reporting on Peloton, Bloomberg's Mark Gurman. As always, appreciate it. Meantime, Monday is the deadline for hedge funds to disclose their U.S. equity investments for the second quarter. This is one of the few ways that we get insight into how hedge funds and some large family offices actually invest. The hedge fund Duquesne bought Eli Lilly, CrowdStrike, Moderna, and Datadog. Meantime, Tiger Global took new positions in Alphabet and Zillow, according to a new 13F filing. Tiger Global also exited positions in DocuSign, Zoom, and Salesforce, reducing its stakes in Snowflake and Microsoft. Coming up, dozens of SPACs have fallen through this year, and there could be more to come. We'll tell you why next. This is Bloomberg. We'll be right back. The SPAC world continues to unravel. At least four planned mergers to go public have been canceled since the market closed last Friday, bringing the year's tally to 42. Those concerns have pushed 89 backers to withdraw plans to raise fresh capital for blank checks. Here to explain, Bloomberg's Bailey Lipschultz. So, Bailey, just how many of these are we talking about here, and why are we seeing so many of them?
Yeah, so as you saw in the chart, that we've seen kind of a growing number that has only kind of shot up since the start of the year, and that's really coming as we've seen over 600 blank check companies on the hunt for deals that are racing against deadlines that either really are built up at the end of the first quarter of next year, some going into the second quarter of next year, but really just over 700 SPACs either with signed deals or chasing to find new target companies to bring public. When you look at some of the breakups that we've seen in the last few days, those are either in things like electronic vehicles, cryptocurrencies, so a lot of high growth technology companies that are ways away from generating any kind of EBITDA. And that's really something we've seen fall out broadly across the actual public markets. So that's part of the reason that the plug has been pulled on some of these deals.
So talk to us about the broader market for SPACs and how this, what this bodes for the rest of the year.
Yeah, so we've seen more than 60 actually close their deals so far this year, and another 100 are live deals. So that means that there actually is a partnership between the sponsorship team and the target company. So you can expect to continue to see some of these getting across the finish line. But the way these de-SPACs are trading, 2022 class is down a median 48% this year. So markedly underperforming the market, markedly underperforming those who went public via the traditional IPO. So you can expect to see some deals getting across the finish line, but there is expectations for liquidations like we saw with the Bill Ackman SPAC, like we saw Sam Zell announcing last week, in addition to expectations that we will see some of these deals being broken just because these terms were agreed to back in December, even through April, when the market was in very different shape compared to where it is right now, where there are so many concerns about a potential recession and what lies ahead with expectations for the Fed to continue to hike interest rates.
So, question, does this trend pick back up when or if hopefully the markets get better, or longer term, are investors just souring on this as a means of doing business?
Yes, sponsors are really optimistic that they can get deals done. That's why we saw Chamath Palihapitiya announcing that they plan to push back two deadlines to sometime next year. Kind of the reading of the room from talking to investors is the idea that as the market rebounds, there will be some demand for some of these SPAC deals to get across the finish line, for some of these experienced sponsors to find and bring private targets public. But the expectation from the people that I talk to is that the future iteration of SPACs in 2022 or in 2023 and in 2024 will really look like what it did back in 2019, where you've got 50 to 60 SPACs filing to go public. They're taking some of these smaller target companies public that maybe don't have the following to get a bank like a JP Morgan or a Goldman Sachs to underwrite their IPO, and will find ways to get deals across the finish line. But broadly speaking, the expectation is that the go-go days that we saw in 2020 and 2021 is very much a thing of the past and more of an anomaly.
All right. Really interesting. Bailey Lipschultz, thank you for covering that story for us. All right. Coming up, how conspiracy theorist Alex Jones made even more money after being taken down from major social media platforms. We're going to have more on that next. This is Bloomberg. In the summer of 2018, Apple, Facebook, Spotify, Twitter, and YouTube all banned the media company of conspiracy theorist Alex Jones, that is InfoWars. That means taking down many of its recorded broadcasts, this after Jones threatened then special counsel Robert Mueller. The platforms all cited some sort of unspecified content policy violation for their decision to deplatform the controversial host, which was supposed to relocate Jones to relative obscurity. As it turns out, Jones's audience didn't quite disappear. In fact, his business became more lucrative than ever. Bloomberg's Max Chafkin took a deep dive into this for us. Max, how is this even possible?
Well, so there are two things that are going on. One is that although the big tech companies banned InfoWars pages and in some cases eventually banned Alex Jones, they didn't take down, you know, they didn't stop the circulation of these Sandy Hook-related conspiracy theories. They didn't stop other people from posting Jones's videos, either in support or in criticism of him. And as a result, even though he was banned, you've still seen quite a lot of Alex Jones on social media, either in the form of him appearing on podcasts. So you've seen a bunch of these kind of contrarian, edgy types like Joe Rogan have Alex Jones on their shows, and as well as just people out there criticizing him. And then the other thing that happened is that, you know, Alex Jones used this and turned it into a storyline where he became this martyr. He does not make money through like a traditional media company does. He makes money by selling products. So there may be a situation where, although his audience, he's not getting the huge numbers, he's making more money off of the audience that he does have because he's been able to activate them by spinning this narrative of martyrdom, which, as we learned during the trial, it simply isn't true. He's doing really well financially.
You mentioned the trial, of course, judge awarding the parents of one of the Sandy Hook victims tens of millions of dollars. There's also a Texas verdict, another one coming up. Are these verdicts, these penalties, actually changing the narrative around him, or are they making him potentially more powerful?
Well, it's hard to know. I mean, what you have a jury award in Texas. That's the $50 million you mentioned. You also have this case in Connecticut. In both of these cases, Jones has been found to have defamed the families, and you have trials to decide on the damages. And the thing is, it's very tempting even now to say, okay, well, this is probably the end of Alex Jones's career. You know, he's gone too far. But people have been saying this for a long time. And, you know, as I point out in the column, you still have lots of people, lots of companies basically enabling and making money off of this stuff. Alex Jones has a book that's coming out. It's near the top of Amazon's bestseller list. There's a documentary, a very sympathetic documentary that has just come out. So you have lots and lots of media types still kind of, like I said, eating off of these conspiracy theories in one way or another. Mm. And it's pretty depressing just because the cruelty, as we saw during the trial, of these conspiracy theories towards the parents was, you know, it's disturbing.
Right. Oof. Yes. Well, you can read more of that in Max's story. Max, thank you for bringing that issue to light with us, and we'll be following the verdict from the upcoming trials. All right, coming up, new analysis from Bloomberg finds that Google Maps routinely misleads people looking for abortion clinics. We're going to have more on that later in the show. This is Bloomberg. We've been covering the changing digital privacy landscape in a post-Roe world, issues with access to information on abortion, and the power that tech companies have to safeguard that information. Well, it turns out that even Google Maps regularly misleads people searching for abortion clinics. This according to a new analysis by Bloomberg News. Let's take a deep dive on this with Bloomberg's Jack Gillum, who went through all of the data for us. So tell us what you found, Jack.
So, Emily, we wanted to just start out as if somebody wanted to find an abortion clinic, right? A very straightforward search that you would put into Google Maps. And when we did that for all 50 states and the District of Columbia, the results were pretty surprising. About a quarter of the cases returned not abortion clinics, but instead what are called crisis pregnancy centers, these places that are often, you know, encourage women when they come in to not get an abortion, and even though they often will masquerade themselves as a bona fide abortion clinic or some sort of doctor's office. You know, this is very different than if you maybe type in a certain maybe fast food chain or type of restaurant that will give you alternatives. In this case, post-Roe, it's led to some confusion among folks that we've spoken with who believe Google, they see the result, they assume that it's an abortion clinic, they go there, and in some cases, they're in for a pretty alarming surprise.
What does this practically mean for those seeking an abortion?
So what it means is that if somebody is in need of this procedure and they go to one of these places and it's a crisis pregnancy center, they can be sort of drawn into this process and be told, sometimes with very erroneous medical information, that they don't need one. We spoke with one woman who, in fact, Googled an abortion clinic, ended up going to a crisis pregnancy center, and then quickly realized that it was not an abortion clinic, was given a rubber fetus, confided in them that, in fact, she was in an abusive relationship, and they tried to convince her that if you just stay in this relationship with the baby, things will get better. So, I mean, it's unclear what sort of emotional damage that did to that woman and other people who are seeking, particularly if they are seeking an abortion. There might not be people who are up to date on this post-Roe world, and it really sort of raises questions in a quarter of these cases that we found, what happens when somebody is in need and when they search and get a wrong result.
What's Google doing about this?
So they say that they have extra layers of verification in place. They have policies, they say, that prevent this, and people can report these erroneous results. There's still the critics we've spoken to ask, well, is Google doing enough, given that they want to index the world's information and that some of these websites are pretty clear that they do not provide abortion? Is there a way to modify that algorithm and take those erroneous results into account?
All right, Jack Gillum, thanks for bringing that story to light. Appreciate it. Well, for more on the implications and the power of tech in a post-Roe world and the impact on tech telehealth, tech investing at large, I want to bring in Susan Lyne, BBG Ventures managing partner, formerly an executive with AOL and Gilt Group, just to name a few. So, Susan, as we were talking about, tech platforms have incredible power in a post-Roe world and obviously have some decisions to make about how they use that power. What are you most concerned about from the perspective of an investor as we see these issues play out?
That's a really good question. I actually think about it more as opportunities that exist. It's really clear that women are not being served, certainly in the 20 states that have banned abortion. But additionally, I think that there's going to be just a huge impact on business overall. And so that always creates opportunity. There will be founders out there who are looking for solutions that enable companies to really address the retention issues, the recruitment issues, and the challenges in a post-Roe era. I mean, there are 2 million fewer women in the workforce today than there were before COVID. So a lot of women left for multiple reasons: remote learning, daycare centers closing, and just the overall caregiver issues that fall to women. Those women have not come back. This new ruling is going to just exacerbate that. We are going to see fewer women in the workforce. We are going to see fewer women advancing at companies. And we all know that gender diverse teams perform better. So unless companies find a way to begin to mitigate this, I think we're going to have big challenges.
So how is this impacting your own investment thesis?
We back female and diverse founders who bring new thinking to sectors where a lot of change is overdue. So it's healthcare, work, finance, education, climate. And they're all areas where diverse founders have been traditionally overlooked. But one of the things we've learned during, the 8 years, 9 years we've been doing this, is that people with lived experience as well as learned experience, people who really understand the end users of a tech platform, the people whose lives are going to be better for it, are generally the people who are going to come up with better solutions. So it's really, for us, it's always looking a little bit ahead of where things are right now to identify where the opportunities exist. And I think we're seeing them in multiple areas, certainly telehealth. That's a really interesting arena right now. Look, in 2020, the restrictions on medication abortions, which used to demand that you go to a hospital or a healthcare provider in order to get prescriptions, that was lifted because of COVID, and those restrictions are still gone. So that opens the way for a whole new stream of telehealth solutions, companies that are both serving women in their own states, but also women nationally.
You mentioned the women that we've lost in the workforce post-pandemic, and there's been a big concern about female entrepreneurs also backsliding in the pandemic. You know, for example, in a tough market conditions, investors might go back to what they know and, you know, continue to back the sort of stereotypical idea of what a founder should look like, which is not necessarily a woman. Are you seeing evidence that female founders and entrepreneurs are, you know, at more of a disadvantage than they were at the start of 2020?
You know, I would say no. We have seen more female founders pitching this year than we did last year, more last year than we did the year before. I think part of the reason is that we invest early. We invest at seed stage, even sometimes pre-seed. Those rounds have been far less impacted by the market changes. And that's where you find most women playing too, right? They have not been doing this for long enough to have, you know, seen hundreds and hundreds of IPOs at this point. So I think for the time being, women are slightly advantaged by what's been happening nationally. In fact, the early part of 2022 saw an increase in the percent of rounds that were led by women.
What's your broader thesis about the market environment? Obviously, we know we're seeing lots of volatility in the public markets. You know, we're hearing the potential for the R word over and over again. We know it's impacted the private markets, that valuations are coming down. What are you seeing and how concerned are you about the macro environment on the funding environment?
Yeah, look, I think that early on, we told our founders to really think hard about how they were spending capital this year. Not a good time to have to go out and raise. If a company is doing really well and sees a path to really capitalize on this moment in order to grow sufficiently to do a giant round next year, that's great. We're all for that, but there are definitely going to be a number of companies that are good companies that just run out of cash this year because venture capital is investing far more slowly. And we've seen it multiple times now where rounds that ordinarily would have taken a month or 6 weeks are taking 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, and that's rough on founders, that's rough on companies, and there are going to be companies that unfairly go under.
All right. Well, lots to continue to watch, Susan. Good to have you back on the show. It's been a while. BBG Ventures Managing Partner Susan Lyne, thank you. Coming up, Galaxy Digital wants to end its acquisition of BitGo, but BitGo is fighting back. We'll tell you how next. This is Bloomberg. Elon Musk isn't the only one walking away from deals in the crypto world. Mike Novogratz says Galaxy Digital now says it's terminating its acquisition of BitGo. $1.2 billion deal there, citing BitGo's failure to deliver audited financial statements for 2021 by a deadline. Let's get into this with our crypto contributor, Shanali Basak. And Shanali, BitGo is fighting back.
Oh, they certainly are, and it's a really interesting deal to look at. Emily, this is one of the largest we've seen in the crypto universe, Galaxy Digital's $1.2 billion agreement, and they've been waiting, the industry, investors have been waiting a long time for this deal to close. Now we know that Galaxy is looking to terminate this deal, and BitGo wants them to pay that termination fee. If you look at the statements here by BitGo's lawyers, they're saying that it's pretty audacious that Mike Novogratz and Galaxy would go blaming BitGo on this merger. They call it absurd, and this is according to the Quinn Emanuel partner from BitGo's legal team here. Both Galaxy and Mr. Novogratz have been distracted, they say, by the Luna fiasco. Either Galaxy owes BitGo a $100 million termination fee as promised, or it has been acting in bad faith and faces damages of that much or more. So again, Emily, kind of like Twitter here, it's not easy to terminate a deal. While Galaxy's shares have been under pressure, they are up on the day. So you do see investors really applauding the decision to let go of what would have been much more expensive last year than this year.
All right. Hang on, Chinali. I want to get into this and more with Kavita Gupta, general partner at Delta Blockchain Fund, a venture capital firm that focuses on blockchain tech, DeFi, NFTs, play to earn, and more. Kavita, drama. What do you make of this latest development and Novogratz trying to get out of this deal?
I genuinely feel like if anybody who is in the VC space would look at the deal and say, hey, the valuations are different from the time the conversation started, took longer than for it to close. Also, after the Luna fiasco, do we really have cash on the balance sheet to do it? I mean, of course, they blame that for SEC filing, they needed some certain more documents, which is very easily provable by the exchange of emails, so could have never been reached here if there was ever an intention of actually doing the deal. I genuinely feel it's the market sentiments than anything else, whether Galaxy can afford it, does need it at the same valuation, or does it even make sense with the business they are going forward with?
You know, I'm so curious about what you think this means for deal making moving forward. This was such a massive deal in the space. A lot had to be said about confidence with a deal like this getting broken up. On the other hand, you look at the investment banks, including Galaxy's, and they seem to be busy. But are these deals born out of a market that is trying to restructure, or deals born out of a chance to build a stronger market at the end?
I feel like it's everywhere, right? So you have deals which is like Coinbase is making with institutional accounts to be able to help them have their private wealth managers do direct crypto ownership. So I feel like the infrastructure play is going on with respect to crypto companies which are going, which exist at a very big level. But acquisition offers, if the valuation is still the old valuation, people are backing out. We have been seeing that since the Luna fiasco. Even at the smallest level, so many funds who have committed the money into early stage investments have also asked money or disappeared or backed out or asked for lower valuations. So we have been seeing it for last couple of months continuously. We have seen the shift in the valuations in a massive way, but I think this is one of those cases where the valuation is still the old build, and the deal has to be done in the market where you can get a better deal.
Another deal in the market that is worth talking about is this idea that you can pay through Reddit for a way to purchase Ethereum through an integration with FTX. You know, FTX is into stocks, FTX is into crypto. But what does something like Reddit do for them? Do we think that more social media platforms will partner with companies like this to get the job done?
Yeah, and I think this is not the first one. Twitter did it already. They just did it with Bitcoin. I think we're going to see more and more Web2 adoption. When you say fintech, there will be an extra layer of payment through blockchain if you directly want to go there. And that is also the idea of the KYC and exchanges coming and getting new customers. Like, how are you going to get them? And I think it's a very smart way FTX is coming. And not only working with social media platform, but any payment, any place where you have an e-commerce option to be done, just add another crypto payment system out there.
All right, Kavita, thank you so much for joining us. Always great to have your take on the latest dramatic twists in the crypto business. Kavita Gupta, Delta Blockchain Fund, along with our very own Chinali Basak. Coming up, Snapchat's 1 million paid, yes, paid subscribers. What that means for the social giant's efforts to move away from advertising, we'll discuss next. This is Bloomberg. Snap's says its paid subscription plan is a hit with more than 1 million users across the globe. The company launched Snapchat Plus back in June, a plan that gives users early and exclusive access to features for $3.99 a month, including changing the app icon and seeing who rewatched your story. Let's bring in our own Alex Borinka for more on this. So, kind of surprising that Snap was able to rack up this many paying subscribers. What exactly are they so excited about?
Yeah, and doing it in just 6 weeks since this product has launched. So a lot of these subscribers are, you can probably assume, the younger users that Snap has brought onto the platform and tried to give them interesting, exclusive new ways to monetize. 1 million, Emily, it's a number that surprised me, but it'll also probably be a surprising but important number for Snap as they move forward and look for revenue streams outside of kind of their beleaguered ad business.
So how quickly and how much do you think Snap can expand this?
I can tell you that this is what they're focused on right now. If you remember their last earnings report just over a month ago, they got hammered in the markets. They basically came out and said, our advertisers aren't spending money on the platform. We're seeing a lot of softness on that side of the business. When you think about Snap, there's two places they can really make money. It's the advertisers, and then it's users, like this with Snapchat Plus. Now, in the social media industry, we know historically it's been pretty tough to get users to pay up. So this seems to be kind of an early win for Snap. Historically, this is a company that's been really good at rolling out products that they know their users would love. And it seems like they're finding a little bit of a winning ticket here, which again, as advertisers tend to be a little bit pocketbook shy right now, will be a potential important revenue stream for them going forward.
Okay, so are other social media companies gonna try to do this, and is it gonna work? I mean, Roger McNamee, early Facebook investor, has been pushing for a subscription model at Facebook for years. You know, could Instagram do this or TikTok?
I think the question will be, what value can they provide? So Snap is giving people like the ability to get to the front of the line in a celebrity's DMs when you direct message them. When you look at Instagram and Facebook and TikTok, right now, it seems like they're rolling out some other user-focused things that are not monetizable, like algorithmically driven feeds or focusing on different types of content. So I do think this is a place where Snap is unique. It's smaller. It's a bit of a different platform than those other names that you mentioned. And again, they've been laser-focused on kind of doing things, maybe zagging when everyone else is zigging, focusing on peer-to-peer messaging when everyone else is focusing on broadcasting messages to the world. So probably a unique case here. We've seen the likes of like Twitter flirt with this a little bit, but we haven't seen any news really of somebody getting to 1 million users paying for something within a social media platform.
So this is my next question. What is going to continue to differentiate Snapchat in a sea of other options?
Yeah, so Snap has been focused around kind of this idea of a camera company, and that seems to be kind of where they're sitting. Ways to create content, their filters and their lenses continue to be differentiated, even though you see TikTok kind of creeping up on them. Also, they spend a lot of time really focusing on person-to-person communication, which again, is not necessarily the main feed or the home feed on a lot of other apps. Snap also, again, kind of is winning over this younger market. Now, Emily, I will remind folks that Snap is a much smaller user base than what we see out there. Their revenue is a lot smaller than giants like Meta and Facebook and Instagram. That being said, it does seem like they are kind of really zeroing in on what that younger 18 to 24-year-old demographic wants and catering to how they want to talk and spend time with their friends one-on-one instead of just broadcasting content to the world.
So 1 million in 2 months, does that mean 12 million in a year?
We'll see. Back of napkin math, that's like 48 million a year at the current number if everyone's paying every month. 1% of revenue there, Emily. But we'll see if those numbers shake out and if folks stick around paying $4 a month for these extra features.
Okay. Alex Borinka, as always, thank you for stopping by. And that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. Tuesday, we're going to be talking about investing in clean energy with Jason Kelly, Ginkgo Bioworks, as President Biden signs the Inflation Reduction Act. And don't forget to check out our podcast wherever you get your podcasts. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. This is Bloomberg.